All right, we should be live. Testing, testing. 1, 2, 3, 4. Hello, good evening, everybody. This is Miles Luigi for an extra bonus stream this week because I said I would do it. So by golly, we are going to be doing it. The game in question came out a couple months ago. It is really good, and it's kind of a classic game, so it therefore doesn't take super long to beat. I could probably beat this in 2 to 3 hours, and I'm not even gonna like try to speed run. I'm just gonna play through it normally. This is Sonic Mania. It was made like the Genesis Sonic games in a way, but it's its own thing, and it has a very interesting history behind it. But I guess the biggest thing is that it is a I did not mean to start a new game as Sonic and Tails. No, I did not do that right. Restart the game. What I was trying to say is that has a very interesting history behind it in terms of its development, because it started as a fan game, and then Sega was like, you know, our fans make better Sonic games than Sonic Team, so therefore, as a result, we have Sonic Mania. That's actually probably not exactly what they said, but a lot of the consensus on I guess Sonic fans is that this game is incredibly awesome. Its Metacritic score is very, very good, so... There we go. So we're going to be playing as Tails and Knuckles, because we can, provided I can select this, right? Yeah, there we go. We do have to play in the no-save mode, which, well, whatever, we can play in the no-save mode, so... Yeah. So, and, yeah, this game borrows very, very heavily from Sonic 3 and Knuckles, to say the least. I mean, it borrows from all classic Sonic games, to be fair, but it has very strong influences from Sonic 3 and Knuckles, including an and Knuckles mode, which is what we're playing right now. So yeah, as I mentioned, this was originally a fan game, and then Sega was like, yeah, no, well, let's make this an actual game. And it's very good. All the people who worked on this game just know what they are doing. And I was very happy to play through this a dozen times, probably. And while it's been a couple months since I've done a playthrough of Sonic Mania, I'm very happy to do another playthrough. So, why Tails? Look at my name. And that should give you the answer. It's the best character. I mean, Tails can fly. You can't, like, I can fly. Okay? This wins every argument. I can fly. It's better than gliding. It's better than not being able to fly. So, anyway, enough about that. So, Sonic Mania, it started a bit like a fan game, but then it became an actual thing. It's just amazing that it did. There are a couple videos that I would recommend if you wanted to learn more about that. I'm forgetting the title of the video off the top of my head, but it was a video by Super Bunny Hop that went into like the backstory of Sonic Manias and the fact that basically it was made by 2 fan game developers. So now, if we could only get that same attention to happen to Paper Mario, where we got like the best like fan people behind Paper Mario to make a Paper Mario real game, we would probably get a true sequel to Thousand Year Door then. But alas, Nintendo is so far has shown no signs that they would like do something like or some kind of collaboration with fans. So, in any case, I should get at least one bonus ring before I hit the end of the act. And I want to say I just kind of skipped them all because I was monologuing there, and I have to remember where my bonus rings are. thankfully, there's lots and lots and lots of bonus rings all like around the game, and it is 12 acts long, so I have plenty of chances. It's just there's like 2 or 3 bonus rings in the first act, and I think I skipped like all of them. Actually, no, I know where I am now. Reorientated myself, so we should be good. Yep, there we go. There's one of the bonus rings. Hey, good evening, Yoshi Gozel. Good evening, Gibbs09. I'll hop in the Discord once I get past Green Hill Zone, so we can bring in some co-coms then. It's been a month since I've played, so I just gotta get used to it again. So these special stages, though, oh man. So if you never grew up with the Genesis Sonic games, or heck, any of the 2D Sonic games, even the all the ones made by Dimps, usually special stages are okay. Sometimes they're a huge pain in the butt. Like, I could probably point out something wrong with a lot of the Sonic game's special stages. Like, Sonic 1's is just a pinball machine, essentially a pinball machine that's a pain in the butt. Sonic 2's requires memorization. Sonic 3, we can talk about that more in a bit. But then, like, then you get to the advanced series, like Sonic Advance 1 was basically perspective, good luck. It sucks. Yeah, no, good luck seeing this perspective. And then Sonic Advance 2s, I don't remember being that bad. Advance 3s, I think, was another perspective LOL good luck. So, and then, of course, geez, all the Sonic 3 Blast was a perspective LOL good luck. I'm thinking of all my special stages. Yeah, there we go. But the first cast ever is almost never difficult, no matter what Sonic game you're playing. And thankfully, that is true here. The first one's not difficult. Matter of fact, in Sonic Mania, it's that damn fifth Chaos Emerald that's the difficult one, which we shouldn't have too much trouble because I've played through this game at least a dozen times, so if I end up failing a special stage, it's my fault, and I got plenty of chances to recover. But speaking of Sonic 3's special stages, the bonus stages, they decided to do blue spheres, which I can't disagree with because blue spheres is kind of cool. I'm going to go ahead and show blue spheres off here. It's probably like the least bad special stage for Sonic Mania, because Sonic Mania, as I would argue, is the best special stage. But the thing about blue spheres is that it's very precise and disorientating. Like, it's not too bad right now, but I am one of those people who will straight up say, when blue spheres gets fast, it really starts to like rack with my mind and brain, just with the way the screen's rotating all around and stuff. And sometimes people say, well, that only happens if you're watching the game, if you're playing and it's not that bad, and I'm like, no, it's that bad. It does hurt. So we want to try to beat the special stage before Tails here gets way too fast in the special stage, because you get faster the longer you're going in the special stage. And there are some blue sphere stages that I just straight haven't beaten because I haven't done the blue spheres enough. I haven't cared enough to do them. So, oh damn it, I totally messed up a perfect. Yeah. So probably not going to be too much other blue spheres, just because I got like a decent number of the medals. I didn't get them all. I'm not achievement hunting, because like I have 8 more to go, and the 8 more that I have to go, I'm like, I just don't want to do this. So thankfully there is a way to grind them. I actually want to say that's next act. I saw a video about it from somewhere. I forgot exactly where. So, but generally speaking, there's like 2 checkpoints you can run between to just grind blue spheres if you want to do the achievement hunting. You really don't get anything other than the achievements, and maybe there's something I haven't unlocked yet. I'm not too super worried about it, so. And that should do the trick. Now let's see if we can get some extra. Oops, no, the sign is way to the left. I'm not hitting that sign. Gibzone, I guess you would argue both Sonic 3 and Sonic Knuckles never went super crazy with their blue sphere stages. As a result, they really weren't that hard. So it's been so long since I've played Sonic 3 and Knuckles, and unfortunately, there's no like Android port of Sonic 3 and Knuckles like there is Sonic 1 and Sonic 2 that ends up actually being the best version of the game. That's another interesting story that I guess I could quick go into, is the fact that Sega has allowed remakes of the first Sonic the Hedgehog and the second Sonic the Hedgehog to come out on Android and iOS. And the remakes like run at a smooth 50 frames per second, and they fix minor bugs, and they're just overall fantastic ports. And they haven't brought them to PC. And it begs the question, why? I want to play Sonic 1 on the PC without emulating it and with no frame rate issues, but complain to Sega. That's the honest answer. So anyway, we're now at special stage 2. This one does not start you off with a lot of time, so your biggest threat like right away is getting some rings from some extra time, but once we got some time going, we should be good. There we go. And now that we got, there we go, I did this special stage perfectly, so provided I don't, like, run out of rings or fall in a hole. That's basically what you need to do. Get to Mach 3 right away, just like that, and we should be able to get this Chaos Emerald really easily. Once again, provided Miles Luigi doesn't flub this up, this isn't a difficult special stage after all, so. Oh, easy as cake, look at that. I'll take it. But I think Sonic Mania hits a really nice balance with the special stages between skill and, well, I guess it's mostly skill because it's a racing game. You're essentially playing a racing game as opposed to, as before, being thrown around a pinball machine or being asked to figure out perspective in a very tiny Game Boy Advance screen. God, I don't know if you could tell, but like I did play through the Sonic Advance games back when, you know, those were a thing, and this would have been like when I was a teenager, and like I actually really liked those games, but those special stages, I never understood the damn perspective on them, and it made special stages so hard because it's like I looked like I'd be running into the rings and I wasn't, and it really was annoying. Like, I didn't understand it. It's like the Game Boy Advance really, really wasn't meant for 3D. And I know some first-person shooters like Doom came out on the GBA, and they worked, but they didn't really play well, if we're being honest. So the stupid 3D special stages in the Sonic Advance games, I'm going to argue, aren't all that good. Flub, thanks for the compliment. Ah, darn it, I just lost my flame shield. But that's alright, we can build a supply of lives. So yeah, lives are a thing. We can actually game over, and it does actually make a difference because we're in the no-save mode, which I don't think I have any continues at the moment. So yeah, if I gamed over, it'd be game over. And I fudged that up. Alright. I'm about to say, you can cheese this boss if I remember right, because these don't even have a hitbox. It's the spikes that have a hitbox, so... Oh, thanks, Knuckles. That boss looks way more intimidating than it is, so... There we go. Well, a rule of thumb, Green Hill gets remade in some way, shape, or form. I mean, sometimes it gets made into, like, something like Emerald Hill, but, like, Green Hill is pretty iconic to Sonic, and I think it's because when people think Sonic, people think of Green Hill. It is the zone that you first played through, and it's kind of made for you to go fast, which is kind of what Sonic is all about. We're going to go ahead and enter into the next zone, which, well, is actually Chemical Plant, nothing too super out of the ordinary. If you're in the Discord, I'm going to hop in. There's somebody waiting in here for me, and provided my Discord doesn't mess up, say hello. Hello, is anyone there? Hello? Hello? I am just going to take it that my Discord has once again decided to mess with me again, so I'm going to restart Discord and be right back. Hello!
Hi, is Discord working for you now?
Now Discord's working! I really don't understand why if I just leave Discord running and then I start a stream, it just doesn't work. So then I restart Discord and then it works. I'm happy that I can get it working without restarting the computer, so...
Yeah.
Alright, we're gonna go back to Sonic Mania here. Good evening, Yoshizilla. Good evening, General Kenobi, if you're around. Hopefully you're doing well tonight. What am I doing going this way? I suppose this is a great opportunity to ask, have you had a chance to play through Sonic Mania yourself, or not so much?
I'm not really a Sonic guy. I'm
okay.
Not gonna lie.
Okay, then.
I played one Sonic game. I never completed it.
Okay.
It was a friend's. I don't know, dude. I'm just a Mario guy. You have to accept that. I'm going to be real with you. Mario is like probably the only gaming thing I play. I had an Xbox for a while and I played COD and Minecraft on it. But then I just kind of was just like, man, I'm not really having that much fun. I don't know. I don't enjoy shooting games as much. Like now, if there was a Mario first-person shooter game, then I consider it.
There's a Doom mod that makes Doom Guy Mario, and it has Mario enemies.
Oh my gosh.
Yes, there's actually multiple Mario mods, but there's a pretty definitive one that I could recommend to you that's really well made, so I need rings.
Yeah.
But yeah, in my case, like, my dad had a Sega Genesis. If I wanted to play a Nintendo console, yes. If I wanted to play a Nintendo console, I had to go to my aunts and uncles, or, one of my other uncles, actually. It wasn't until the one Christmas I got a Nintendo GameCube that I actually had a Nintendo console. And that's not to say I didn't play Nintendo games. You know, I went to my aunts and uncles or the other uncle's house to play them. But growing up as a kid, I was, I guess, a Sega kid in a way, but the only games I liked playing were the Sonic the Hedgehog games, so these games are my childhood, actually.
Nice. Yeah, for... So, funny thing, so my first console was the Wii, because, yeah.
Okay.
I remember my mom and dad, we bought the Wii as a family, and like we always played it together. But then once the years passed, it eventually just became mine. Because I'm the only one who plays it now. I mean, occasionally my dad, like, we play Mario Party. It's so funny because he originally sucked, but then over the course of like, I'd say 100 times we've played it, he got better and... you know, he's actually good.
Oh, boy.
Dadzilla strikes, like... yeah.
Dadzilla gets good at Mario Party, so... But yeah, it was actually around the time I got my GameCube. I also got an N64 as well, because it was somebody else's N64 that they just gave to me. And that's where I got my experience, for example, playing through Paper Mario fully the first time. I had played it before at actually my uncle's house. This was the time that I played through Paper Mario and got stuck before Chapter 1 because the darn Black Toads, I couldn't get past them.
You didn't? No. Miles, they said don't go talk to Merlin. Are you... Well, okay.
I didn't know who Merlin was!
If you're 5, then okay, I can understand.
I would have been at this time maybe like 9 or 10. I didn't know who Merlin was, so I thought like you had to prove yourself and go beat the master.
Oh, that's right, you told me this story.
Yes, I thought you had to go beat the master, and I couldn't do it.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing.
I just couldn't do it. That's why I made a big point, like, this is long ago on my YouTube channel, the point that I made that, oh hey, you can actually beat First Master before you start Chapter 1. Yes, you can do it!
will you live? No?
You kind of have to over-level yourself a bit, put a lot of level-ups into HP. Also, ooh, I almost fell off there.
You reach a certain level, enemies don't give experience.
That's correct. But the thing is, if you do actually grind out, you can get Mario up to around 30 HP, actually.
Oh, nice.
Which is enough to just continually eat mushrooms and have a Goombario attack, which is enough to last long enough to beat Master 1.
But I thought Miles Luigi didn't want to level up HP. Just throw on the HP and FP plus badge.
You don't have any HP or FP plus badges at this point in the game.
Yeah, I know. If only you had more than just... How many? There's 3 HP pluses and 3 FP pluses, if I remember correctly?
Yes.
Wait, let's see. One from the shop, one in... Yeah, okay, I was right. There's one in Forever Forest, there's one in Chapter 1 in Koopa Village, and then there's one you can buy from the shop. But in Thousand Year Door, you can probably get, Well, no, it's unlimited. Get all the HP pluses you want.
Yeah, it's unlimited there.
What's the max number of HP you can have in D2ID? Does anyone actually know? Like, is it 99?
You can level it up to 2... Oh, geez, I actually don't think there's a limit. Never mind. I think you can level it up all you want. Though the actual, like, in-game cap is 999 with cheats, so...
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
But eventually, once you reach a certain level, Amazy Daisies are gonna give one experience.
Yeah, you can get up to level 99, and I want to say if you put it all into HP, you can, and the technical cap, and it would assume that you have a game genie
is
999.
Wait, I remember someone saying this. Whenever you reach a certain amount of HP or something and it caps out, you actually have to get rid of the HP and level it to something else.
Like, is there a cap to it again? I should know this. I know. BP cap is 99. If there's a cap to HP or FP, I would actually like to know. Because I know with Action Replay, you can get it up to 200. Or 999. Is it actually 200? Maybe I thought of 200 because maybe it's actually 200.
Well, all I remember is someone said that once you reach a certain level of just something, I don't know if it's BP, HP, or FP, like, eventually you have to, when you level up, you take, like, the level up from, like, HP and put it to FP. So it's like, you, like, your HP is capped out. So if you, like, you level up FP and it takes away your HP or something. Like, 5 of your HP. I don't know. I think I just heard this.
I don't think level ups do that. I do know that if you go to Shet Ripo, you can adjust your stats.
I know that happens. Yeah. I don't know.
That's how you get Danger Mario going, so.
Oh, yeah, dude. Danger Mario.
Mm-hmm.
You know, speedrun routes don't actually do that. Well, only 100% does that.
Ah.
We use Peril Mario.
You get Mario to 1 HP because you get more attack from the Mega Rushes than the Power Rushes. And...
Yeah, well, actually, we do use Danger Mario, but we don't go to Chet Ripo at all. We used to, but we don't anymore. We do a nice setup with Double Dip and Point Swap. I'll let you see if you can figure it out. Our stats at the end of the game is 10 HP, 10 FP, and... I think 15 or 18 badge points, but that doesn't really matter. How would you theoretically get to 5 HP or lower?
Well, there's a couple of methods to do it. I know a very popular method to do it is to use the point swap because it's very controllable. It's not hard to get to 1 FP, so... There's also the trial stew, but I want to say in a speedrun, getting a trial stew is like way out of the question.
Yeah, no. Definitely not. So, we don't go to ST once.
So yeah, Trial Stew is out of the question. If you do know, like, enemy AI, it is possible to line up the AI to where you can drop to 1 HP. That is still dubious, especially if, like, there's certain chances the enemy could do certain attacks.
Well, here, I should have been more specific. How would you get to 1 HP or 5 HP or lower on the Shadow Queen fight?
Oh, geez, okay. You have one chance right at the start of the battle because she starts with a Thunderbolt every single time, and that does 7 damage, and if you're at 10 HP, that drops you to danger immediately.
Yeah, but she has other attacks that can kill you.
Yes, but her first attack is always the Lightning Bolt. Although, to be fair, I think it could either hit Mario or the partner.
Yeah, it can. It's 50-50. Yeah. Here, I'll just go ahead and tell you.
Okay.
So basically, what the route does is you do a failed power bounce to waste 3 FP, and then you, Then you use the Double Dip badge and use a Boost Sheet and Point Swap, and Double Dip plus power bounce is 7 FP, so once you use that, you'll be at 3 FP, and you can just swap it.
Oh, well, there you go.
Now, the way to get into 1 HP, which the All Crystal Stars route does, is you use the Charge Badge, which wastes 1 FP. Then you use Double Dip Blue Sheet on Mario, and then you do nothing. And then you use Double Dip again, but use the Point Swap, and it's at the FP is at 1 FP, because... Charge costs 1 FP, and Double Dip costs 4 FP, and you use it twice, so that's 9 FP.
I guess point being, the point swaps are a very stable and safe way to drop yourself into peril. Compared to the other methods I told you, which includes Trial Stew, too difficult to get, managing enemy attacks, which...
What does that do?
Oh, Trial Stew, it's a Zesty recipe. I forgot how you make it again. Oh, shoot.
It's not important, just what does it do?
It drops your HP to 1, FP to 0, but it fills your star power. It yields incredible results.
Oh, that's right, it yields incredible results.
It's the only item in the game that actually heals star power, so it has that use.
Yeah, oh, so by the way, why would there be a recipe that's like electrify, dodgy, or sleepy? Like, you put in a positive, like a positive status element, and then you do the sleeping status element. It's like, oh, So you basically have a 33% chance to fall asleep. That's cool.
Yep.
Yeah,
I fell a bit behind here I bumped on the bumper, so I got some catch up to do.
Miles, I got a question. I want to see if you know this.
What's
if you had the Feeling Fine badge on and you used a poison shroom, what would happen?
Oh, you either, because the poison shroom can do this, and I might run out of time here, damn it. You either heal fully, or it normally poisons you or drops your HP, so... Oh, shoot. Yeah, that spike. Oh, damn it. This path has no rings. I'm going to have to do this one over again.
Rip.
Rip special stage.
Don't worry.
I gotta continue. Worry. We're good, everybody. But I want to say poison shroom with Feeling Fine will either heal you fully or knock your HP in half.
Yeah, maybe.
I forgot, honestly. If you combine it with double pain, though, it's a possible you killed yourself. I know that.
Oh, yeah. So I remember in your LP, you, you used double pain and return postage in the Glitzville again. Like, to go fight again. That's exactly what I did. I was just like, you know what? I'm going to do that. It's
why,
so much
why
fun.
Not? Get some use out of that return postage badge.
I know. It's very useless. You go all the way down to the pit. You know what? I think the only reason to go down to the pit is just to experience that you've done it. That's the only real reason.
Yeah, the actual, like, badge you get rewarded from. Yeah.
Dude, you should get, like... You should have gotten something like... I don't even know. What's a very overpowered badge? Or, like, what would be in a very overpowered badge?
Oh, jeez, I'm thinking of my badges in Thousand Year Door and what would be a really overpowered badge.
Oh, yeah, I actually didn't know what happened, but if you go down and take a second trip through the pit, Bonecale isn't actually there, which makes sense because he's a boss.
No, instead you get the really creepy ambience music.
Wait, what?
Yes, if you go down the pit of 100 trials again, when you make it to floor 100, nothing is there but really creepy ambience.
Oh, like the, Oh, my dog's barking. Is it like the theme when you fight Hooktail? Like, you know the theme
no.
that plays after? Oh, it's
no.
something else?
It's a special ambience theme.
What's it called? I need to look this up.
Oh, jeez, I'm not sure what it's called on the OST. I'm sorry. You could probably find it if you search for Pit of 100 Trials Bonetail's Lair.
Oh, okay.
So... No, darn it, I did not mean to go into the poison jelly. But yeah, it's a unique theme. It doesn't play anywhere else in the game, I can tell you that.
Oh, I found it. Hold up.
Okay.
Alright, screw this. I'm watching another video. It's camera quality.
Okay, then. Alright, we got another chance here at the fifth Chaos Emerald. Let's not fall so far behind, because that's what screwed me up last time, so... This stupid side path here, it has the blue spheres, but it's also a pain in the ass to go down.
Oh my gosh, that sounds so creepy and, like, awesome at the same time.
I need to get more rings than this. That's not good.
Oh, okay, so I see. It's basically just kind of like a bunch of sounds, like... Yeah, that's what I could imagine something like that.
Alright, I haven't been doing too good. Can I get this? That'll help. Yeah, getting Mach 2 right now will help, so. Alright, let's try to collect more rings this time, why don't we?
Talking about unique themes, there's actually unique themes in Paper Mario 64.
Yes, there is.
The sun. The happy sun theme, if you go back there. Do you know about that?
Yeah, go back to, well, the Sun and Flower Fields. There is a unique theme for it, so, and it's kind of jazzy, if I remember my Paper Mario right, so.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember it. Is there any others? I guess you can consider, well, no, not really.
Darn it! Did not mean to hit the bomb! Ugh. That might cost me, hopefully not.
Is there any other unique themes?
I do know there are some unused tracks in the OST.
I know about that. There's like a theme called Bootler Scares Feist T that's unused, I remember. Because I never heard it in the game, and I heard it online. I was like, I think that's an unused track.
It's time to reference the cutting room floor, so. I need more rings than that. Okay. Well, I'm building up continues. It's not what I needed. I want the damn Chaos Emerald. I'm getting close, though. Please be rings. I need some more rings.
Are you trying to get all the rings?
Yeah, I went on the wrong side unless I get it here. Oh, shoot. I am not going to get it. I hit the bumper. Nope, nope, nope. No! Damn it! I went on the wrong side. I didn't get the more rings. I got to do better at the start so I don't fall so far behind. That's why we're not getting the Chaos Emerald. Ugh.
Rip.
But yeah, cutting room floor. Like, there is actually like an intro kind of theme to Paper Mario, if I'm remembering right, that is unused but is really similar to the actual intro. So,
Something I know that is unused in the English version. The partner theme is actually a different tune than the English theme. Oh, and actually, Miles, I don't know if you know this because you probably haven't seen that many speedruns. The English version and the Japanese version of the final Bowser fight are actually slightly different.
Oh, really? I was not aware.
The English version is better by a lot. It adds like extra drum like beats. Like it adds drums into it. Like the original one, it didn't really have. Like you couldn't really hear it that well. But in the English version, it like adds a bunch of drums, I guess, if that makes sense. And the tune is like a little different. Like at some point. I don't know, it's hard to explain. I'd have to compare it and show you.
Oh, okay.
And I think the Yoshi's panicking theme is slightly different on the English version.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't
noted.
Know.
All right, give me another purple. I've got like a couple purple stacks. Here we go. There we go. Let's do this one. I was hoping to set up bigger combos than that, but whatever. Eggman's AI here is just weird in that he'll either like do surprisingly well or really bad, and right now he's actually kind of doing really bad. So, Puyo Puyo player, I am not. I'll say that. So, thankfully this boss doesn't require you to be competent at Puyo Puyo. Which yes, this is definitely a surprise boss when you first hit it. It's Mean Bean Machine, or Puyo Puyo, just randomly is Chemical Plant's boss, and it just makes sense, so. Yeah, I didn't even try to build up many combos at all on Eggman. It was just not playing well, so me just continually hitting him with single combos did the trick there. But yeah, depending on Eggman's AI, he can actually put up a threat or whatnot. I don't know what his AI does, honestly. It's chaotic. With that, we're going into our first original zone, the one that you probably saw if you saw trailers for this, Studiopolis. This is the stage that has like a billion references in it, so feel free to start counting them.
Oh, Miles, I actually found it here. I'm going to send it to you just so I guess you can listen to the different theme if you don't mind.
No problem. I should be able to make this without flying. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, soundtrack for Sonic Mania was made, once again, by another fan game kind of person, T. Lopes. Ooh, fantastic job with the soundtrack. I think it is something you can purchase, or if not, download it. Get it, it's good.
Alright, you should be able to tell the difference if you listen. Like, it's very easy to tell the difference, and it's easy to tell that the English is, like, awesome. The English one is just way better than the Japanese version of the music.
Really noted. Can I jump over the stage? No, I can't. Okay. We're just gonna take this way, because I want to say this takes me over here, and there's another special stage ring where we can take another shot at the damn fifth Chaos Emerald. Let's not fall behind this time. Some more of the blue spheres here before I go for some of the rings. Alright. Okay, I was about to say, that jump might be a little on the late side. Maybe I should have gone for more blue spheres, since I'm now going to hit the... If I do this right, hit the arrow, so... Oh, nope, I'm not going to hit the arrow. Never mind! That might hurt, so... But I'm pretty close to Mach 2. We should be okay. Let's get there. There we go. Some rings on the right here. There we go.
So, Miles, do you still do the Mario Alone challenge, or are you done with that?
Almost. Sometime before the end of the year, I wanted to stream myself doing the Pit of 100 Trials, as the only part of Mario Alone in Thousand Year Door that I haven't done. So,
you've beaten Chapter 8, or you've beaten the game?
I have beaten the game.
Using no partners! So, wait, I just realized, how did you technically use Yoshi for the
Armored Harriers?
Yeah, because yes. You're forced to.
Yeah, there's no getting around that one. If there is some exploit that I could do to get around that, I would, but there isn't.
Actually, so something funny, someone was saying, like, obviously as a joke, but like I was saying this because like it's true. Someone was saying, yo, we should have a Mario Alone percent category, and I'd be like, yeah, that will last until Chapter 3 when you have to use Yoshi. It is literally impossible to do that fight without Yoshi.
Well, if you make that one exclusion, then I'm kind of curious what sequence breaks you do specifically in Mario Alone. Like, are we just talking about Mario Alone in battles, or are we trying to exclude the field abilities to the most you can?
Well, probably just battles, because... Yeah, I'm pretty sure someone could possibly like route some way to do Mario Alone in any percent Japanese, but it wouldn't be easy. It probably wouldn't be easy to route.
If it could be done with like extremely minimal partner usage, I'm actually kind of interested, admittedly.
Yeah, well, you kind of need a partner in order to beat Shadow Queen, so yeah. Not even to attack, just to do the, just to use a boost sheet on Mario. And stuff.
I'm sure I could always ping JD Aster and ask him to make a challenge. He is the challenge expert, God. After all, so.
Yeah, freaking P, like, Mega Rush list, Mega Rush P list, Hit 100 Trials, pre-Oaktail.
Yeah.
When's Prologue Pit? I'd like to see him do that.
Well, we'll see. This is our first of the hard-boiled heavies. That was kind of the, I guess, unique thing about Sonic Mania, is that some of the bosses are these, like, egg robos that got, like, their own personality. And it comes with this really awesome, like, spanky music, I'll describe it as. So, I like it a lot. T-Lopes did a good job. There's some more backstory about these guys if, like, you want to look into that thing, but, I mean, this is a video game. You don't have to look into that to enjoy the game. Just know, this is one of the hard-boiled heavies. And speaking of speedruns, in the original version of Sonic Mania, it is possible to fly over the loading trigger for this boss and completely skip the boss fight. It's unfortunately been patched out, though.
Nice. Sorry, I was practicing Paper Mario stuff. It's kind of hard to talk when you're on push to talk.
Understood. But yeah, it's been patched out. But it's been patched out. But in the original version, you can fly over the loading trigger for the boss, and you don't have to fight him.
Yo, here, you ready for this? I'm gonna do VHS with one hand. It's gonna turn out. Yeah, no, it's not gonna work. I already give up, and I didn't even try it.
There we go. Can we find any TV monitors? No. I have no clue where any of the TV monitors are outside of Green Hill Zone's first act. I know where the TV monitors are there, but then the stupid signpost decided to spawn way in the left, so that didn't work out so well for me. But yeah, early in the stream I mentioned that the Sonic the Hedgehog games were kind of like some of my earliest childhood memories, actually. And I have a little interesting story to go with that. The fact that I went through stages of my life getting further in Sonic 3, but never being able to complete it until I was a teenager.
Nice.
And then finding out Sonic and Knuckles was a thing. So Sonic 3 and then ultimately Sonic 3 and Knuckles was like the game that kept growing for me.
Yeah, nice, dude.
Mm-hmm.
I still, even though this is a different topic, I still need to beat Odyssey. It's been out for a month and a half, and I haven't, well, I have beaten it, but I haven't 100%ed it. Because I'm a 100% guy. I got it 100%.
Well, Higsby isn't here, and I'll allow the Odyssey spoilers. Have you done Darker Side?
No. Wait, you've been to Dark Side?
I have not been to Darker Side. I've been to Dark Side, but not Darker Side.
Oh, so, okay, you are past the end of the game.
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
so
I am.
Yes, I can vent to you about Darkseid. Darkseid was bullcrap. Oh my gosh.
The moment I realized the game wasn't healing between bosses, I'm like, yeah, I need to go get a 6-heart and really be careful with my health. I ended up beating Darkseid after I got a 6-heart the first time, but with 1 health.
Wait, can you like go to different worlds and get a 6-heart and it will transfer between worlds? Okay,
yes,
I didn't
yes,
know
you can.
That.
And not only that... Not
so
only
I did,
that,
I can do it with 3 hearts.
Not only that, there is actually a hidden 6-heart in Darkseid.
I heard about that. I have no idea where it is. Okay, but dude, the 10 hint hearts. Oh my gosh, just there's too many. And have you done the Bullet Bill stage?
That's that one special area that I heard is pretty infamous that you have to do a bunch of long jumps in.
Yep.
No, I haven't.
Well, it sucks. You're gonna have one hell of a time.
All right, good to know. It sucks. No, I haven't done it yet, so.
Yeah. What have you done in Darkseid?
Just that boss rush. I actually haven't done any other moons because I wasn't aware there were other moons in that stage quite yet, so.
Uh-oh.
And I haven't gone back
Sorry.
To it. I'm about to say, is that long jump challenge in Darkseid? Ugh, I'm gonna fall off. No! Hitting
well,
that
sorry
spike.
For spoiling you about the one of the moons.
That totally messed me up, me hitting that spike, and I'm like, yeah! Recover, no.
Yeah. Have you done any of the hint arts without, like, looking up a guide? Because I haven't.
I actually haven't looked into a guide yet. I'm trying to do as many moons as I can, just through my own curiosity and in what I can find.
Yeah. That's what I'm trying to do, but if I get stuck for a really long time, I have to look at a guide.
So, I know, for example, I was working on the Water Kingdom last, and before that,
wait,
I was like...
Wait, the Water Light Kingdom?
Shoot, there's two, isn't there? The one with... Oh, shoot, they both have Dory! Ah! The one that's
wait,
more
wait,
of a...
What?
The one that's not a beach, how about that?
Yeah, that's Light Kingdom.
Okay, Lake Kingdom.
What do you mean the one that has Dory?
They both have Dory! Oh my gosh, I forgot! Odyssey decides, let's put Dory everywhere! So
wait, really? Wait.
Dory is in Seaside and Lake Kingdom. I didn't mean to go back.
Oh yeah, that's right. Okay. Dumb moment. When you said Dory, I instantly thought Finding Nemo Dory.
No!
Yeah, no.
I'm talking
no,
about
no.
like the big
I was like, what?
Dolphin
yeah,
thing?
Yeah, no. That thing is called Dory, I forgot. Dude, I just get so tripped off because, like, they're both Water Kingdom, so it's like, yeah, I don't know. I got confused for a second, I'm sorry.
It's the big thing that says swim with me if you swim near him.
Yeah, it's both in that kingdom.
So, But yeah, I've done Dark Side. I am around 400 moons, so I haven't unlocked Darker Side. And I haven't gotten all the moons in any of the kingdoms yet. Matter of fact, Cascade Kingdom, I was like 3 moons from completing that.
That's
I have no clue.
How you pronounce it.
Yeah,
that's
Cascade. How you pronounce it. I was 3 moons away from finishing it, and I have no clue where those moons are, so.
All right, so I've gotten all of the moons in Mushroom Kingdom, aside from the achievements. I still have to complete the achievements.
Nice.
I've gotten all the moons in Cap Kingdom and Purple Coins, actually. I've gotten those two. I've gotten all the moons and purple coins in Cap Kingdom, Cascade Kingdom, Sand Kingdom, Lake Kingdom, Cloud Kingdom, I think is next. And Lost Kingdom.
That's next the one where next. You fight Bowser, right?
Yeah, that's very easy. Like, I didn't use a guide at all. But the moons are free.
Okay. Good to know.
Yeah, so far, and this is the moon number I have is a very special number. It's 624. Wanna guess why it's a special number?
624 because it's 312 if you half it?
No.
Alright, what's so special about it?
Here, I'll give you a hint. It's something revolving me.
Okay. It corresponds to the date of your birthday.
Yes.
Yay!
You are actually right, yeah. 624 is my date of birth. So my half birthday is coming up in 11 days, actually.
Well, there you go. I've never paid attention to half birthdays, holy moly. I don't even know what my half birthday is.
Well, what's the date of your birth? Well, you probably don't want to say on stream.
Actually, I'll say that. It's August 13th. Yes, I have a 13th. So as a result, I sometimes have birthdays on Friday the 13th.
That's the same as my grandmother's, actually.
Really?
Uh-huh. And funny thing, she was actually born on Friday the 13th.
Oh, boy.
Wait, let's see. Okay. Your half birthday is February 13th.
February 13th? That's just before Valentine's Day. That should be easy to remember.
Yeah. I think the funny thing, my cousin's birthday is March 6th, and my sister's birthday is September 6th. They're both 6 months apart.
Okay, well, there you go.
Yeah, it's pretty funny.
There you go.
Oh. And one of my friend's mother's birthday is the 24th of December. They have a Christmas Eve birthday.
Well, there you go.
Yeah. That would honestly suck that. Well, I mean, not 100%, but that would just be like, what the heck if you had a birthday on Christmas or Christmas Eve or whatever.
I have a close relative that has a birthday on Christmas Day, so it is a thing.
Oh, nice. Oh, hi, General.
Hey, good evening, General. I can barely hear you. I hope you don't mind if you could pump up your volume. And in comes the weird buzzing sound in the background, if you can hear that. This is actually, so Studiopolis had like a ton of references, and the fact that Sonic games, this game especially, have multiple paths, we've missed some of the references that were on alternate paths. But this reference I will tell you, because it's a really, like, oh my gosh, they referenced that. So there was a buzzing sound there, and that buzzing sound was the same buzzing sound that played during the Sonic 25th anniversary livestream.
Nice.
Very, yes.
Very, like, oddly specific.
Yes.
Is that anywhere?
There's, like, a fan or something on the background.
Yeah, I'll tell you that's a reference to that, and, yeah, that's one thing about Sonic Mania that I love, is that there's a lot of little nods to, well, people who play Sonic games, and as somebody who was into both Mario and Sonic franchises, and, like, up until around Sonic Heroes, I was, like, really into every single new Sonic game. Yeah. So, well, there's a little bit of a story there. So, Sonic Heroes, this before was like the last main Sonic game that I played, because the next ones were like Shadow the Hedgehog and Sonic 06. And the thing is, I had a friend who picked up Shadow the Hedgehog on the GameCube. This would have been around like 2005. So I watched him, like, for a couple hours play Shadow the Hedgehog, and, like, I thought it looked okay, but, like, at the same time, it looked really, like, tedious. Like, oh, you have to beat the game, like, a dozen times in order to get the best ending. It is just, like, I didn't want to do that. So I never picked it up myself, and also didn't help that it didn't reveal very well, so...
It's one of those games where, like, you have to play it a couple times to get certain endings.
Yes, that is correct.
Dang.
Is that any better?
That's yes. Better.
Yeah.
Success!
Good evening, General! I never picked up Shadow the Hedgehog because I didn't want to play through it multiple times and it didn't, like, look super interesting. Even though, you know, it was a Sonic the Hedgehog or Shadow the Hedgehog game, technically. And then Sonic 06 came out, but it didn't come out on a Nintendo console, so guess who didn't play it? Me. And thank goodness, because, yeah.
You did not miss much, trust me.
As I know.
That's right, General. It's funny, you're in General, and your name is General.
Like, I chose General Kenobi because I'm a huge Star Wars fan, and I think I'm also a really big Star Trek fan, so I'm trying to kind of merge the two together.
There you go.
Holy crap, I just realized Star Wars comes out tomorrow, at least the special showing, and I'm going to go see it.
Oh, I am so excited for that. That is going to be so awesome.
Oh boy. Well, usually with movies, it's easier to avoid spoilers, but no spoilers for Miles Luigi, because in a couple weeks, end up seeing it, so...
Don't worry. If we spoil, you, like, ban us forever.
There we go. Trash compactor. No challenge for us, because we can fly. Once again, flying is the best. I told you Tails is the best.
So, Miles, pro mode kind of ruined me. I was playing Paper Mario, and I tried to attack the guy you get the bump from.
Mm-hmm.
And I just got the bump.
You tried to attack in Battle Wacka, and there's no Wacka battle.
Correct.
If you want to get technical, there is...
Wait, what?
Okay.
What's this about?
So... In Paper Mario Pro Mode, you actually fight Wacka to get Wacka's bumps.
Oh my god.
Uh-huh. And the funny thing is, there is technically a Wacka battle programmed into the original Paper Mario, but it crashes Paper Mario.
Oh my gosh, fighting Wacka crashes Paper Mario?
Someone
submit that to Strider.
So,
he probably knows that about that.
He mentioned it in one of his videos, I forgot which one.
Ah, yeah, gotcha.
So... but yeah, basically Clover took that Wacka battle and made it not crash and did other things to it. I don't suppose you're very familiar with Pro Mode, are you, Yoshizilla?
No, not really. I need to play it.
Do you want to be spoiled about Wacka or no?
I really don't care. Go ahead.
Alright, I'll spoil Wacka because I kind of want to hear your reaction just knowing this. So, Wacka, when you fight him... he starts off kind of basic, but he has an attack that hits you three times, each for one damage that gets doubled to two damage, so he can really easily rack up a lot of damage to you if you can't guard. Thing is, that's the first time you fight him. Every sequential time after that, when you fight him, he gets stronger.
Oh my gosh.
So take the fact that he does a multi-hit attack, and he does it multiple times, his damage output starts to go high really quickly.
Oh my gosh. Well, this is what we get for smacking Wacka for the Wacka bump. But I just like the cute, adorable Wacka that I can easily just get a bump. You know, I didn't kill him, I just, you know, hurt him a little.
You hurt him.
I tried to start the battle by using a bomb attack to lower the HP and Wacka just put away.
He says, "What the heck are you doing?" or something different when you use Bombette instead of your hammer, too.
Yeah.
It's a unique conversation, but I kind of forgot what he said, actually.
For me, he just went away.
Oh, really? He didn't even give you a bump? He should have given you a bump, at least.
Nope, he didn't give me anything.
Aw, how dare he.
Luckily, I was playing on my Wii U emulator, and I just saved state for it.
Well, there you go.
Well, that's a way to do it.
Alright, this is the last special stage. This one, provided you don't fall in the holes, because there's a lot of holes in this one, is not as difficult as the others. Well, at least I find it, so... Biggest thing is not falling in the holes, though. Yeah, honestly, it's probably best if you get to Mach 2, but no faster. Which is exactly what I'm going to do, actually, is I'm going to get to Mach 2, and then I'm just going to avoid the blue spheres and just try to get rings now.
All of a sudden, all the blue spheres just draw to you.
The biggest thing is that since this course, specifically the last Chaos Emerald, has so many holes in the course, being at Mach 3 just is kind of a detriment, in my humble opinion, so Mach 2 is enough. There we go, we'll cut that corner and we got all the Chaos Emeralds, there we go. Now, Tails can be Super Tails, so we can start abusing Super Transformations to trivialize bosses, which I will be doing. Why wouldn't I be doing? I could actually turn Super right now. I have to land first. There we go. Let's do it. General, if I may ask you, do you have any experience with Classic Sonic or Sonic Mania?
Sonic Mania, no, but as for the classics, I've played all of them. I had a Sonic the Hedgehog 3 and Knuckles on my computer for a CD-ROM for the longest time.
Oh, the CD-ROM version of Sonic 3 and Knuckles, that's a thing.
So yeah, it had all of the Sonic the Hedgehog 3 games on it.
Yeah. So, I might as well, this is actually probably a good time to discuss about it. So yeah, as I said before, Miles Luigi, since Sonic 3 was kind of a childhood game of his, he had to come back to it, like, year after different year, because he kept getting stuck at different parts of Sonic 3, and ultimately getting Sonic 3 and Knuckles, so it was just the game that kept on growing. Also, I'm just going to fail this Blue Spheres right away, because I don't want to play it. But the first time I got stuck in Sonic 3, it was actually to the Hydrosity Act 1 boss, because like I didn't understand how to even attack it, because I kept getting washed away from him, and it was like, what the hell? I couldn't get past him.
Wait, Miles, did you get stuck in Chapter 1 and beat the Master?
In Paper Mario, yes. I never beat the Master, though. It wasn't until I got my own N64, which would have been after I got my own GameCube, that I actually fully played through and beat Paper Mario. And then I finally actually figured out that I needed to talk to Merlon this entire time. Anyway, go ahead.
For me, Sonic the Hedgehog 3, the spot I got stuck at was, Marvel's Own Act 2, where you had to go on the Rising platform thing. It took me forever to figure out, you just push up and down the platform, go up and down.
Oh, so you just described point 2 in Sonic 3 where I got stuck, which I found out is actually a point where a lot of people ended up getting stuck, is the damn barrel in Carnival Night Zone Act 2.
Yes.
I
tried using a bubble for that extra bounce to make the platform move.
I did too! I did too! I tried everything. Like, I knew Sonic games had multiple paths, so I also like scoured everywhere in Carnival Night Act 2 to try to find if there was another pass past the barrel, because like I couldn't figure out the barrel, and I thought I was just bad at games, and I just needed to jump better to get past it.
When I found out what you were supposed to do, it was one of those really moments.
Yes, it was. Because I specifically remember needing to like use the level select code to go to Ice Cap. I remember doing that.
I think at one point I tried getting being supersonic before I got to there to see if that would help at all.
I never had supersonic until I had Sonic 3 and Knuckles, because I wasn't good at Blue Spheres when I was a kid. That should have counted as a hit. Come on, Eggman.
Eggman's had so many names over the years.
Yeah, Ice Cap I actually briefly got stuck on as well, because in the first act, there's kind of like this loop that you constantly go down and down and down on until you break some pillars by landing on a platform. And I just never thought to land on the platform. I just kept going down and down, and I'm like, when does this end? And it never ended, and I never figured it out for, once again, it had to have been months till I went back to it. Oh, Sonic 3. The game I kept getting stuck at, Sonic 3! No wonder it sticks out so much in my head.
I guess if we're talking about dumb stuff we may have gotten stuck at, I got stuck at the Toad minigame in Color Splash.
Toad minigame in Color Splash. Since I haven't really played Color Splash...
Oh, he has a key. There's like a key or something that the Toad gives to a Toad with a crease in his head. And, well, I got stuck on it for whatever reason, and you just had to paint the Toad. And I completely forgot. I just didn't know. I just wasn't thinking of that.
Use the game's main mechanic. To be fair, I'm not going to give you a bunch of shenanigans about it, because to my understanding, Color Splash was really similar to Sticker Star, and Sticker Star had some really, in my opinion, bad puzzles, so hard to figure out puzzles. So I assume Color Splash is the same.
So Miles, have you had a chance to play the 3DS version of the Mario and Luigi Saga?
Oh, no I haven't. It is currently sitting in my shopping cart, on my Amazon shopping cart actually. I will probably pick it up next time I order something on Amazon, so.
I put it on my wish list for if someone wants to give it to me for Christmas, but yeah.
See, my big thing is I have a 3DS that I hacked, thanks with the help of Alex who taught me how to hack it, and I need to look...
You don't have a 3DS capture card, so you hacked it.
Yes. So I need to look into how I can safely update my 3DS, because I still need to play Metroid Samus Returns, which I do want to play, but I know it's going to ask me to update my 3DS.
Miles.
Yeah?
Miles, I think I have the perfect guy for you.
You do?
Yeah. One of my friends knows how to do that stuff.
Okay. Let me know.
Yeah.
About the 3DS version of the Mario and Luigi game?
So, the 3DS Mario and Luigi, I've only just heard some basic things about it, mainly that it's a pretty good remake, and that it is, you know, the same game otherwise.
It's essentially the same game, they changed it up a little bit to fit with the DS, but probably the biggest thing that I found a lot of fun was the Bowser's Minions.
Oh, okay, so the new minigame they added.
Featuring the return of the three dumbasses.
Oh, yes! I appreciate that, actually.
And the floating gumball.
If there's one set of characters that just, I think, is really enduring, and I don't mind seeing, Nintendo can bring them back all they want, it's the three dumbasses.
Oh, you're talking about the three minions?
Yes.
Bowser's Minions. Or not Bowser's Minions.
They're in a couple Mario and Luigi games. But
yeah,
I think,
Bowser's
they...
Story and Dream Team.
They originally appeared there, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for future Mario and Luigi games to be good, they have to be able to beat you playing as Bowser just punching things in the face.
Do you know what's one thing that... the developers always do with Mario and Luigi games that I just love?
What's that?
The humor with Luigi.
That I can agree with.
They just always make the funny moments with Luigi because, you know, they got to.
No TV monitor there. Okay. But yeah, Mario and Luigi games are almost always written well. That's not their issue. So the only issue I have with Mario and Luigi is that they kinda are a little bit stale. And I say that because I never really got the motivation to play Paper Jam. And part of that might have been because I was still salty about Sticker Star and Color Splash.
You know, Paper Jam got a lower rating than Sticker Star by IGN.
I didn't know that, actually. Gosh darn.
Yeah.
I thought Paper Jam did pretty well. It kind of did its own little thing, combining the Mario Luigi and Paper Mario.
Okay, one thing that just kind of annoys me is when people say Paper Jam's a Paper Mario game. It's not. It may have Paper Mario in it, but it is not a Paper Mario game.
Fair enough.
It has Mario and Luigi in the title. It doesn't have Paper Mario in the title. It's clearly a Mario and Luigi game.
Yeah, it is a Mario and Luigi game. I don't think I've ever taken the high path in this level before, because I, like, never seen any of this architecture before, so I'm going to keep on this high path. There goes the fire shield. That was actually a really useful thing to have in this stage because of all the ice blocks. The music just cut out. No, that occasionally happens. No, this stage's music is really good. T-Lopes, I must hear your songs.
Are you okay, Miles?
I'm okay. It's just sometimes, I don't know why, but music cuts out. I'm going to go super. Yeah, we've been talking about Mario so much in this stream about Sonic. Yeah, this is another one of those new themes. That's okay, honestly.
Probably my fault.
But yeah, this is one of the new stages, Press Garden, which is on one hand a newspaper factory and on the other hand a forest where they mill the paper. So really clever, honestly. This is actually, other than Studiopolis, my favorite zone. I could actually say all the original zones in Sonic Mania are probably my favorite zones, actually. So, yeah.
I haven't seen or heard much of the new Sonic game. Has anybody had a chance to play it?
Alright, so Sonic Forces, that new Sonic game, I haven't had a chance to pick it up and play it. I've been told since I like Generations, I could probably get some enjoyment out of Sonic Forces, but otherwise it's not really all that great, is from what I've been told.
I've actually got a friend who is majorly into Sonic, and I think he likes pretty much anything that has Sonic in it, even Sonic 06.
So, I didn't have any plans on getting Sonic Forces, but like if it goes on to a Steam sale, I may add it to my library at that point. Maybe I'll play around with it, because I know the big thing is you can make your own Sonic OC, and it's like, now it's you saving the world with Sonic. So, but yeah, actually Sonic Forces' story slightly connects with Sonic Mania's because of that whole, the phasing thing we're doing. That's being caused by a ruby called the Phantom Ruby, and it's something that's in both Sonic Mania and Sonic Forces.
They gotta give me something new to collect other than the 7 Chaos Emeralds every single game.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Speaking of the fact we're in Stardust Speedway, which is the Sonic CD level, Sonic CD was another childhood game of mine, and that was a game that for the longest time I could never get past Stardust Speedway, and it was because of the boss. I could never beat Metal Sonic. He always got to the end before me. That I could never beat him!
I think I played Sonic CD once, maybe twice. It was okay.
It's different is the best way to describe it. It definitely stands out and it's different, but I'd argue it's really good, so. About to say, I think Sonic CD is like on Steam for ridiculously cheap too, so... It got a remake, and that remake is really good. So...
I think one of the best things that came out of Sonic Boom was the... No, I'm sorry, Sonic CD was the Sonic Boom song.
I'm about to say, it was Toei Animations that did a whole bunch of, like, animated sequences for Sonic CD. So... I'm not sure who did the Sonic Boom song, though. It's probably someone. But yeah, Sonic CD is that game that has that notable thing of having two awesome soundtracks. So, which if you don't know what I'm talking about, for whatever reason, somebody somewhere in the US was like, Sonic CD's music is too weird, so they decided to make another soundtrack for it for the US version of Sonic CD that's also really good, so... You might get some opinions from some people saying, hey, the Japanese soundtrack is better or the U.S. soundtrack is better. And I'm just going to say, well, I grew up with the U.S. version of Sonic CD, so I guess I'm particular to that version, but both versions are good. I'm not going to say one's better than the other.
For me, one of the major make or break things for any video game is definitely the soundtrack.
It's kind of a miracle. It's like, oh wow, like one soundtrack is hard enough to compose. Compose two, and then both are good, equally good, I'd argue. I could stand to play through Sonic CD again, just because I know the remake adds Tails, and Tails is the best character, and I think it would be cool to play through Sonic CD as Tails, so... I think it is sitting in my Steam library too. If it's not, it's not expensive at all. I know it is a cheap thing on Steam, so.
Never really got into Steam too much, other than I did play that Ori and the Blind Forest. Thanks, Miles.
Oh, you're welcome. I hope you enjoyed that. So there is an achievement for getting through Stardust Seaway Act 2 in under a minute, and I just haven't gone through the effort of getting it. So I know if I went through the effort of getting it and I knew the path to take, I could probably get it, but it's just... admittedly, I just kind of follow my instincts when I go through a Sonic the Hedgehog level. I've never, like, memorized a level's layout and figured out the fastest way to get through it. So, which is like a requisite... skill if you were to say speedrun this game, so...
Yeah. Speedrunning, man.
Mm-hmm.
Speedrunning a game where the main thing you do is run around at the speed of sound.
Yes. And I've already gone over a minute, so much for that. But yeah, Sonic CD, thankfully I did, after the fact when I was older, did eventually beat Metal Sonic, and I did beat it. But it, like, Stardust Speedway, the Bad Future theme, I've listened to for probably hours of my life, actually, because I got stuck at Metal Sonic.
I'm sorry, who is the other co-commentator?
Yoshizilla.
I'm Yoshizilla.
Yoshizilla, okay.
What is that? I wouldn't call this commentating. I would just call this two people hanging out with Miles while he streams.
Yes.
Okay, I'm just happy to be here.
Mm-hmm. Alright, so we got a really long fight with Metal Sonic ahead here, so this'll go on for a bit. There we go. So I know this little mini boss here that is part of the Metal Sonic fight is supposed to be. Ooh, wow, okay. thought he was going to roll up into a ball. It's supposed to be a Game Gear reference, and I have no experience with Game Gear Sonic the Hedgehog games. The only time I ever played them was a part of the Sonic Mega Collection on the GameCube, and I didn't find them fun, so I never really played far into them. I don't know if anybody's had any other experience or has played the GameCube Sonics and really liked them, but like I thought they were kind of boring, honestly.
I only played one GameCube game.
Yeah, I had a Game Boy growing up. I mean, before I had my GameCube, to make a slight correction to the record, I said I didn't have a Nintendo console. I did have a Game Boy, so.
And yes, we all had Game Boys. We could have gone to the Game Gear.
I didn't have a Game Boy.
That was a lot better, but because the Game Boy was smaller, it was the Game Gear Bomb.
No, I had a Game Boy, and, let's see, we're definitely talking about childhood Miles Luigi, but I do remember playing through the Mario Land games, for example, so Mario Land 1, 2, and 3.
Mario Land 2 is always going to be part of my childhood, because it was the first video game that I ever played.
Yeah, that's going to stand out, isn't it?
I was super excited when Higsby did a Let's Play of that game.
Ah, yeah.
Suing Ball of Death.
I haven't been counting hits, but Metal Sonic should be dead pretty soon here. There we go. We did it.
Yeah, that robot in the back is a premium hall.
Giant robot under construction. Yeah, towering robot. But yeah. Now we're going off to the Hydro City Zone, and no level transition, it just goes into the next level. And that is actually going to be a complaint I have with Sonic Mania, is that they built up level transitions throughout all these levels so far, and then there wasn't one when we went into Press Garden, and then there wasn't here. What the fudge, where's my level transitions? You spoiled me.
It probably makes sense.
Miles? Oh, sorry.
The original level transition for this level, you're falling off of various things and Knuckles, so...
That is true.
Miles, I notice that you say fudge a lot more than you actually curse.
Habit is the honest answer. I built up the habit to say fudge, so...
Yeah. I say frick a lot, if you haven't noticed.
One of my college school mates... actually, I think it's Nate who did this, would often say, oh, fooey. So... Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Why don't you just say heck?
Heck. You could just be like Evil Pop-Tart and just straight swear outright, so...
that's what he does.
Evil Pop-Tart just swears outright, so...
He has and he probably wouldn't even care if there's a kid there.
No, he'll just casually say swears too.
I mean, if he's just casually saying it, it's not like you get a reaction about anyone who knows him. It's just like, oh, he swears. It's normal.
That's the evil Pop-Tart thing to do.
He swore a lot in Super Crappy World 2. That was hilarious.
Yeah. I could tell you, since I knew him back when I went to college with him, yeah, he just kind of swears a lot, so...
Unless you swear a lot? I mean, I've heard you swear, of course, but...
Yeah, I just generally try not to unless it's warranted, so...
What do you mean?
If there's a good reason to swear, like, say, for example, I accidentally hammered my thumb when trying to put up a picture, then I'll swear.
Yeah. That wouldn't be...
There are just most appropriate moments.
And I've sworn on stream and in Let's Plays before. It's just
I have yet to swear on stream.
Okay. Yeah. Unless we're talking about Evil Pop-Tart in a professional setting, then he'll mellow out his swearing. But otherwise, he's as bad as a pirate, honestly.
Rip him.
It's just kind of a personality trait. It makes him really good at Cards Against Humanity, I'll say that.
Oh my gosh.
I'm about to say, have you played Cards Against Humanity, Yoshizilla?
I did, but it was a custom game. Like, people made their own Cards Against Humanity cards, and, like, because I played it online, and they, like, I haven't, like, actually played it. I probably never will play it, because I don't like that kind of stuff. I've seen videos on it. Me playing it? No.
Okay. Yeah, it helps.
First time I played that game, I wish I could remember what the question was.
I played Apples to Apples. There you go. Which is pretty much the censored version.
I looked at the question, read it, then read it again, and I just bursted out laughing. I could not stop because of what one of the responses was. It was just one of those, oh my god, what did this guy just do? I wish for the life of me, I can remember what the question was.
Dude, no one can upload a video about Cards Against Humanity now because of YouTube's state. Like, with wanting... What is it they want? Like, family-friendly videos?
Oh, the advertiser boycott stuff.
Yeah.
I guess it depends how much YouTube's automated algorithm likes or hates the video, but chances are it probably flags Cards Against Humanity as a... also, by Knuckles. Cards Against Humanity as a... not advertiser-friendly. I can see that.
One of my videos got hit for no reason. Like, there was nothing in the title. Luckily, it's gone, but I mean, I don't even make money off of YouTube anyway, so it really doesn't matter. I mean, I don't know if you do, so I don't know if it's a big deal.
I make enough to get a dinner, so...
So, like, $2.
Well, more than that, but...
Yeah, I'm just kidding. But yeah, one of my videos got flagged, and I was just like, okay... The thumbnail has Luigi sitting on a couch, a GameCube controller, and a title. The title is called Luigi's Day Off. Why is it flagged as not family friendly?
That's right. Out of my own curiosity, I like looked at past videos once and I saw, I think it was like part 4 to Super Mario Omega was marked as not advertiser friendly, and I'm like, why? And why part 4? But okay.
No, why part 4?
I've actually had one of my more recent videos copyrighted by Disney. It was best Lightsaber videos.
My most popular video has a copyright claim and it sucks. It has 15,000 views and it's copyrighted.
Is it at least music copywritten, where YouTube gives you the ability to remove the song?
No, I can't remove the song.
Aww.
I don't know if you get money. Do you get money from views or whatever on YouTube?
So, since I can give you a little bit of insight into this, I am in a place where like I have a management company who used to be Necessary as Gaming, but like then they sold like their managed partnership to... I forgot who it is again. It's been a while since I interacted with them, though. But I have a managed partnership... Well, not managed partnership, a partnership through them. There's a difference between managed partnership and partnership, where basically they take the risk and responsibility from my YouTube channel, and in return take a cut of the ad revenue. That's basically how a partnership works, because trying to get a partnership from YouTube directly is basically impossible unless you got some chops and can actually get in contact with real people at YouTube instead of robots, so... But, relatively speaking, I don't make much on YouTube. I usually stay mum about that, but if you want to be honest, it averages out to maybe like 20, 30 bucks a month, so.
I mean, that's better than nothing.
That is better than nothing. Just before, it can help pay for a meal.
Yeah. I imagine you. How many subs do you have? You have like 5,000?
I'm approaching 8,000 right now.
Oh, okay, nice. Yeah, I've got... I'm nowhere near that, because my channel's very small. It has 800 subs. Well, almost 800 subs. But one of my videos got 15,000 views, which is like, what the heck? Do you make revenue off of views?
So, to answer that question, there is a measurement, I think it's called CPM, where basically it's like the average amount of money you make off of a video per 1,000 views, if I remember the measurement right. Consult somebody before you consult me, because I really didn't pay attention to it.
Yeah.
The amount of money you make is, I think it used to be proportional to views, but I think it's actually now proportional to what ads played on the video and who actually watched the ads and whatnot.
People just have ad blocker now.
Mm-hmm. Or they click skip ad.
Yeah. Here, I'll make like 50 different accounts and go watch my own ads on them.
Technically against AdSense terms of policy, which, since you don't have an AdSense account, you'd probably be okay.
I used to have an AdSense account, but then my friend like said, hey, you should partner up with Freedom. I'm like, okay.
I did have the YouTube Red for a little while, and I realized how much it was hurting YouTubers. I stopped using it.
Yeah, YouTube Red's a thing, so that's another thing. If you are a partner and somebody watches your video with YouTube Red, those views are counted directly towards your revenue, actually.
Nice.
Well, thanks, Knuckles. Push the buttons for me.
Yeah, I mean, I don't necessarily plan to make a living off of YouTube. I would like to make it to at least 1,000 subscribers.
Yeah, well, there you go. There's a goal. I will say, unless like you do legitly get lucky and get enough viral videos out there to do it, no. You're not going to become the next PewDiePie and make millions. It's not going to happen.
Really, YouTube comes down to luck. It really does.
Yeah, it kind of does.
The thing is like I've seen some like YouTubers, or I think it kind of like, I mean, not necessarily annoys me, but like it's true. There's some YouTubers who like, I'm not really going on gaming, but like different things. There are some YouTubers that put no effort in their videos and they get like thousands of subscribers. And then you see the people that do put effort in their videos and they like barely get recognized. It's like, what?
Yeah, so basically if you, let's say nowadays YouTube's like video recommendation algorithm is like all, just all AI, so if you could figure out like how to game that AI, a YouTube future is for you.
Yeah, well like I said, I don't really plan to make a living off of YouTube. If anything, I'm at like almost 800 subs now. I post at least one video a month, because I do, like, I don't do, like, gaming or anything. I do something Mario-related, but it's different. I don't know. Maybe next year I'll get to 1,000 subs, but I really don't know.
Well, we'll see. Also, I really like the clever reference that when you're playing as Tails and Sonic is piloting the tornado, he wears his goggles that was the cut item from Sonic 1. It's just a little detail like that. It's just like, well, most people wouldn't notice unless you're a big person who played the original Sonic the Hedgehog and like knew about this. And oh, I'm one of those people that knew about it.
Yeah, I have a little bit of everything on my YouTube channel.
Nice. But yeah, I mean, some people can, without being the next PewDiePie, make a good living on YouTube. Like, to earn at least enough. Like, I know someone who has like 42,000 subscribers and he kind of is making a living off of it. I don't think he plans to forever, but like he's making a bit of a living.
So I will just say, speaking objectively about it, ad revenue from YouTube is a very volatile source of income, because you're always a subject to however ad revenue is counted, which is a changing thing. And you're also subject to the fact that maybe your channel could be taken down from copyright strikes or something like that. And it's never
well,
seemed
to... Well, he's not making a living to where if he loses his channel, he's screwed. There are some people that do that I know of. It's like...
Yeah.
There are some people that, like, try to exploit the system, and if they get, like... If they get flagged as not family friendly, they'll like delete the video and re-upload it until the system doesn't recognize it.
That doesn't surprise me, honestly.
Yeah.
The YouTube AI robot didn't like that. Come up with a different video description and title and tags.
I don't change my tags. All my tags are the same.
Yeah, at least to our best understanding, right now, YouTube's recommended video section is basically an AI robot that tries to figure out what you want to watch.
Yeah, so apparently I want to watch plane crashes, so that's... Yeah, YouTube has randomly put, like, top 10 most shocking plane... It's like, does it look like I want to watch those? Are you trying to make me not want to ride a plane again?
There's a really weird video that YouTube keeps recommending to me called Important Videos, and it's like this image of like a dinosaur, like a baby dinosaur, and I'm like, what is this even?
Oh my gosh. Here, let's go to my... Let me go to my YouTube homepage and see what it's recommending me now.
Oh jeez, I ran out of rings. Not to the super caterpillar boss, I didn't want to die here. Let's not die.
Alright, so on my homepage, we have two live streams, one Kirby Live Radio. There's another video, Saves and Speedruns, that's probably something I would watch. Family Guy episodes, I don't watch Family Guy, never will. A Mario plush video, which I do watch a lot of those, so it's like, yeah, and I've seen that video actually. Ranking the Paper Mario games. The Mario plot problem. Yeah. So some of these recommendations are like, what the heck? I mean, not too out of the way, but yeah.
Without looking, I'm sure probably one of my recommendations is to do a Nostalgia Critic episode.
But I meant to spin dash, not start flying upwards, but okay. But yeah, we're in Mirage Saloon Zone. This is another one of those new zones, which, in a way, it almost doesn't feel new because this is totally based off of a cut zone in Sonic 2. But I guess it's new. It doesn't feel new to me, but it's also a really well-designed zone, so who really cares? It's another one of my favorites. All the zones in this game, they're all good. Ah.
So, Miles, you ready to get that Twitch affiliate soon?
I am almost there. The only requirement I had to meet is, like, the requirement to stream, like, at least 7 times in 30 days. And this stream should actually push me over.
Streams.
Yeah, this stream should push me over, actually.
Nice. People can cheer to you. So far,
yay!
I've got, like, $51 in revenue that I can't take out yet because... I need to hit the requirement, which is $100. So, hey, I'll get there soon, and I'll have $100 free dollars that I can use now. That's nothing to complain about.
Well, when/if we get there, because I think I'll get there. I've got enough of a following. Thank you, everybody, for watching. I'll have to figure out what people actually. If they actually wanted to subscribe to me, what they would want from emotes for me, because I actually have no clue, honestly.
An M.
They want the Miles Luigi logo.
Well, I mean, your Discord logo is something else.
Yeah, that's the Miles Luigi logo, so...
You gotta come up with an avatar, dude. Well, I mean, is your avatar, like, what is it? Like, you have it on Twitter and Discord.
Oh, the little Ori with sunglasses, yeah.
That could be your avatar. That seems like it is.
I would argue that, yeah, that is my avatar. So I suppose, like, an Ori sunglasses thing.
You can maybe commission an artist to make, like three custom emotes of those.
I know some artists.
Miles happy, Miles rage, Miles cry, whatever.
The guy you used to make my intros, Shiro Points, actually would be like my first go-to person to ask for that, so.
Yeah, I have these emotes that one of my friends who's an artist made for me, and I also have this that I made myself, hold up. There you go.
All right.
If you can't tell what that is, that's me giving a thumbs up. It's titled Young Z, because that's basically my nickname for the Paper Mario community. That's what the Paper Mario community calls me, Young Z.
So now we're at Oil Ocean Zone. My compliments to the Sonic Mania dev team, because before Sonic Mania, if you'd have asked me what my least favorite zone from Sonic 2 was, I probably would have answered Oil Ocean. And they actually made it good, so. Yeah, I brought up that, like, I totally got stuck playing through Sonic 3 and Sonic CD as a kid. I didn't really get stuck playing, like, either Sonic 1 or Sonic 2 as a kid, though. Partly because those games are a bit more run to the end of a stage than Sonic 3 or Sonic CD was. And mostly because it wasn't until I was older that I was actually good enough to beat the games, because I would usually game over. And I would always just think as a kid, you know, I'm still a kid, I need to get better at the game, because that was the atmosphere behind video games. That was the arcade atmosphere. You gotta get better, you gotta get good, so. Just thought I had to get better at video games, you know?
You gotta be a god gamer.
Just gotta get better at video games, you know?
Miles, do you consider yourself a god gamer?
I wouldn't go that far. Maybe if I beat your world record in Paper Mario, maybe.
But you have to beat it by a frame to be a god gamer.
Okay.
Dude, oh my gosh, that was such a great moment. Funny enough, no one's made a Reddit post about it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they make Reddit posts about a meme world record category, yet not mine. Like, what the heck?
And not only that, Reddit kind of has a policy against, like, self-promotion, so, ugh. Well, if you want me to, I could post it on Reddit. I usually just browse and lurk Reddit, honestly, but I could post. I haven't posted in years, though, on Reddit.
You don't have to. You really
okay.
Don't have to.
Game the system by asking a friend, hey, can you post this on Reddit for me?
Yeah, say Yoshizilla gets being the first person to ever get 141 and by one frame. What a legend.
You know, that night you did that, I had your stream on in the background while I was beating Mario Odyssey.
Wait, really?
Yes,
you,
I did.
You had my stream in the background when I got that time?
Yes, I did.
Did I scare you when I yelled no?
When I started hearing you talking about possibly get winning world record, it was around when you were on Junior Troopa, I actually started really paying attention.
Possibly getting world record?
Yeah.
You mean getting 141?
Yeah. Or... Well, I think you actually did say 141 now that I think about it, so...
Yeah, because really, my goal wasn't world record, my goal was 141. This is the thing. In speedrunning, you should set your goal to be to get a very fast time. My 141, I'm pretty sure 140 is possible, but I really don't want to deal with it at the moment. Maybe if I'm committed, I can go for a 140, but at the moment, I really don't care. My goal is 141. I got it. Goodbye. End of story. But yeah, pretty much. If your goal is world record, that will get taken away eventually. Your world record will get taken away eventually, but no one can ever take away your 141.
There you go. There's Yoshizilla's point of view on it, and I actually say that's a pretty mature point of view. I agree with it.
And this is the thing. I have seen people do this. Obviously, I'm not going to call names out. There are people who, if they can PB but not world record, they reset. Like, if they don't have the world record and they're, like, on PB pace and they can't... They can PB, but they can't world record, they'll just reset.
I'll be back in just a second, guys.
Alright. So, yeah, now we're on Oil Oceans Act 2, where they decided to take the Sandopolis gimmick. In Sandopolis, it was ghosts, and in Oil Ocean 2, it's smog filling the screen and slowly draining away your rings if it gets too bad. I gotta say, it was a nice nod to the mechanic, too, and done really well.
Mm-hmm. So, Miles, what would you do if you got a world record?
Be happy?
Yeah, I mean, of course, there's nothing wrong with being happy about getting a world record, but if I got world record, but I didn't get, like, my goal time, I wouldn't be as happy. Like, I want to get my goal time. I don't really care about getting world record. Obviously, it's cool to have world record, but it's like, you gotta get your goal time, dude. Most people who don't speedrun, like, don't really get it. They, like, people just usually think, oh, world record's the only thing that matters. It's really not. Really, the main thing that matters is getting a fast time. So, yeah. Like you said, that's my point of view about speedrunning goals, I guess.
Well, there's a lot of people who speedrun games, but I will say you have a very mature opinion on it, and one that I agree with, so...
Thank you. I mean, not everyone goes for world record. There are other speedrunners I know that, like, go for good times.
Alright, yep, this is the end of the stage. No reason to go into that sub.
The funny thing is, people could say that I only care about getting world records because my goal times, at least some of them, they just happen to be world record. So people would just, like, look at it and say, oh, hey, you only care about world record because you're going for this time. Really not. I'm going for that time because it's a fast time. Like, in the Paper Mario Any Percent No Wrong Warp, a different category that has less RNG, my goal is to get a 212. I'm pretty sure a 211 is possible, but my goal is just to get a 212. World record is a 213.
Mm.
So people could say, oh, you just care about world record. No, not really. It just happens to be my goal. And it just happens to be world record.
Your mic's gone really quiet again, General.
Yeah.
Is this any better?
That's better.
Okay. Yeah, eventually I'll get a decent microphone. This is my backup.
Okay.
Mom, I notice, like, every time I join your stream, I talk about speedrunning at one point. I'm sorry.
It's your topic, and I don't mind, honestly. To me, streaming is about entertainment and being social, so... And enjoying video games. In this case, Sonic Mania. I don't do too much Sonic content, and it's just like, oh my gosh, this Sonic game is awesome. Let's do a Tails and Knuckles run.
Miles, when are you going to speedrun, what is that Luigi game you were playing the other day?
Luigi and the Island of Mystery? The ROM hack?
Yeah. Or no, I'm sorry, Mario Gives Up. It was like a hard game. You used a lot of save states.
Oh, Mario Gives Up 3 is probably what you saw. I beat it.
Yeah, when are you gonna speedrun Mario Gives Up 3 save state percent?
Oh, like, boy. No plans?
Yeah, I'm joking.
Sorry to interrupt, but this is probably my favorite zone from Sonic 3.
Sonic, interrupting. Sonic and Knuckles, technically. I'll be that guy. But I could see that.
Especially Act 2 with the music. That's just awesome.
Miles, it says keep out. Why are you going through there?
Because that's how I go forward in the level.
Very true.
Where else am I supposed to go?
Home. Just go home and eat some pizza.
Okay.
Dude, there was pizza like at my class today, and oh my gosh, I missed out, and I didn't get a slice because I was eating a Subway sandwich.
Oh. Well, Subway's still good.
Yeah, Subway is good. I got bacon, lettuce, tomato. So good.
Still good.
But it's like pizza is like, you have to have pizza. Well, it's a good thing I'm gonna have pizza on Friday.
I work at Publix, so it's very tempting to want to get the chicken tenders just about every single day.
You work where? You like work in a restaurant or like a fast food restaurant?
I work at Publix.
Oh.
I'm not familiar with that
at all, since you work there.
No, I don't, but it's all good.
No employee discount.
Man, dude, that hurts.
Well, it makes sense because it is a grocery store, so if you had a employee discount, yeah, we'd probably buy out the store or buy out all the chicken sandwiches or whatever.
That makes sense.
True. Yeah. My sister actually... Oh, go ahead.
Before Miles Luigi got into IT, his job before that was part-time as a clerk and photo specialist at Walgreens.
Nice.
Yes, and I did get a employee discount, but there were some food items that didn't qualify for the employee discount.
Rip.
Stuff like milk and whatnot.
Yeah, my sibling works at a restaurant, and I think it's his family members get, like, a certain amount, like, they get a discount.
This time last year, I was working at Toys R Us.
Nice.
There you go.
I almost died.
I would imagine.
But yeah, I said Sonic 3 was the game for me that, like, never ended. So I didn't know Sonic & Knuckles was a thing till about the internet was a thing, and now I say I was, like, 12 or 13, when I found out, oh, hey, there is an add-on for Sonic 3 called Sonic & Knuckles. So I had to go to, at the time, it was a store called Electronic Boutiques. It eventually became GameStop, by the way, that I went to. And unfortunately, at the time, they did not have a copy of Sonic & Knuckles because they didn't sell Genesis games anymore. Ah! So I asked my dad for a copy of Sonic & Knuckles, and he managed to find one for me, so...
Nice. Oh, well, are you done? Are you gonna say more stuff?
So the only other thing is because I played Sonic & Knuckles when I was actually, like, older and competent in games, I never got stuck at it. But, I just find it funny that, like, through my life, I kept getting stuck at Sonic 3, and then, oh, I got further, and then I got stuck at Sonic 3, and oh, I got further, and then I beat Sonic 3, and I thought that was the end, and then I found out, oh, Sonic & Knuckles is a thing, so... It to me, felt like multiple games, you know? It didn't feel like one game.
Yeah, nice.
You could partially blame that damn barrel, because, yes, Miles Luigi did get stuck there.
Hey, Miles, this happened a while back, but do you think you'll ever continue your 1% Let's Play of the Metroid game?
Ooh, Metroid Fusion. So, I stalled that because I realized, like, with how busy I was only going to be able to record, like, once a month. And I realized I am going to get rusty at this game so much, there's no way I'm going to be able to play consistently. And considering that I might have 2 to 3 hours to record, and that 2 to 3 hours might be wasted, and then, like, I'll have to wait, like, 2 to 3 weeks to a month to, like, record again. I just got very demoralized about being able to beat Metroid Fusion 1%. So as a result, I kind of quit. It is still something that I'd want to do. And now that I'm streaming more, maybe I could, like, do part of it, or part of it is I'm streaming. That is a series, though, that I would like to edit down. So, like, if I did stream myself doing Metroid Fusion 1% and failing a bunch, I would like to eventually take the footage and make, like, an actual real Let's Play out of it.
On my last trip to Georgia, the entire car trip, both going to and coming back, I recorded an entire Let's Play of the Metroid Fusion game.
Well, there you go. I take it you didn't do 1%, right?
No, it was just how far can I get? I went through the entire game. I went back and got what items that I could, and that was about it.
Okay.
Miles, when's the low percent Luigi's Mansion run where you have to get rank H of the, like, the rank H mansion? You have to collect no coins or pearls, and you have to... You have to collect no money at all, no pearls at all, and you have to end with rank H.
I've never done that before.
Yeah,
That sounds terrible. I don't want to do it.
Oh, yeah, it probably is. There is a low percent speed run of it, I think. Which, I can't imagine someone doing that.
No. I mean, Luigi's Mansion is already, like, an interesting speedrun game, because you do this really weird clip, like, after the first boss to get to the last boss.
Well, that's the, that's, like, the fastest category, any percent, but there's also any percent no OOB, 100%, any percent PAL, and 100% PAL, because they're actually different versions. I think there's a max percent where you must collect every money in the game, like, all the money.
Can't miss any of it. Can't miss any pickups.
Yeah, and you can't get hit at all.
Oh, that too, yeah. Good luck. Oh, these spikes. I hate these spikes so much. I was about to say I'm going to go super, but I can't go super in that animation. Okay, I'm going super now.
But you can fly, dude.
I can fly, but whenever I'm in that weird tumbly animation, I can't start a flight.
All right, well, anyway, I actually haven't had dinner yet, so I should probably head out and
all right.
Go eat dinner, because it's been a long day for me. I was at my school until 5 or so, because I had to get a story reel done for my finals, and it was pretty close.
All right, well, have a good night. I'm about to say I'm probably going to be done with Sonic Mania, because we're actually getting kind of close to the end here, so... have a good night, Yoshi Zella. Thanks for joining.
You gonna end the stream, or?
Once I beat Sonic Mania, I'm gonna end the stream, yeah.
Yeah, alright, we'll see you guys later. I actually might stream later, too, if you're up to check that out.
Maybe we'll raid ya.
Oh, gosh. Well, that's if I start streaming by the time... by the time you're done. I don't know. Don't... I'm sorry. I'm self-promoting myself without even trying to. My bad.
It doesn't bother me. As long as somebody isn't, like, doing it, like, with malicious intent or unethically, I'm okay with it, honestly.
Make sure you subscribe to Twitch.com. Okay, I'm just kidding. That's where you... Man.
That's about where I draw the line, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. I'm not... I'm just kidding. Don't. Please don't. Alright, goodbye. See you later.
Alright, have a good night.
You too.
Ooh, geez, okay, I'm happy I didn't get crushed there, but oh my gosh, wow. That was a weird interaction with the rocky enemy.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Alright, we got another boss battle against another one of the hard-boiled heavies, and this is one that, because other than my first playthrough, I've always had super for, I've always just cheesed this boss, and I've never, like, learned how to properly hit it. So. Because this hard-boiled heavy, I actually think this one is a she. She has the whole chain ball above her head, and as a result, it's kind of hard to land hits on it, or on her, so.
The old spinning ball of doom trick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I just jumped into her without super form when I first played through the game till I won. Which is how you kind of beat every Sonic boss, so what am I talking about? There we go. Yeah, for those of you who haven't played Mania before, we have 12 zones, and we've actually gotten through 10 of them. There's only two more left, and both of them, in a way, are kind of a final zone-like. At least our next zone is, out of all zones, Metallic Madness. Since I went completely in the blind as to what the zones were in Sonic Mania, I honest to God thought that A, this was going to be the last zone, and B, why did they bring another zone back from Sonic CD and Metallic Madness of all of them? But once again, Sonic Mania, their dev team did a fantastic job, and it's like, oh my gosh, they made me like really like Metallic Madness. How did they do it?
Well, considering that this is probably one of the best Sonic games we've had in years.
Mm-hmm. That's definitely part of it, I'll say that.
Well, the Sonic Generations was good.
Yes, yes, yes it was. There we go. Oh boy, okay, lost all my rings there.
I haven't seen it yet. Oh, there it is.
So something that I haven't discussed about yet is the fact that Sonic Mania did come out for like all consoles and PC. By all consoles, I do mean like the latest consoles, Xbox One, PS4, Switch, and PC. And because, you know, I'm PC Gaming Master Race, I elected to get the PC version, which a couple issues with that. A, they delayed Sonic Mania like 2 weeks for the PC. Which, at the time, it was just like, okay, I guess the PC version is coming out last. Like, whatever, the console versions can come out first. Like, no one paid too much attention to the fact that the PC version came out later. And, like, I purposely had to avoid seeing anything Sonic Mania because, like, I wanted to experience it fresh. So, like, I was, like, 2 weeks, or it was out, and it was like, I can't see anything. I want to play this game fresh. Like, I didn't want anything spoiled about it at all. Not zones. Not any gameplay other than what was shown at the trailer, nothing. And that was tough. And then it comes out on Steam, and then it turns out De DRM is included with it. And, like, at the time I didn't even know what De Nouveau was a thing, and I've learned since that it's actually, like, a really super bad DRM technology. It's like, gosh darn it. If I would have known this, I would have just gotten it on the Switch and not waited the 2 damn weeks.
I've pretty much been the exact same way with Star Wars The Last Jedi. I've been avoiding spoilers like they're the plague.
Yeah. I'm gonna have to start avoiding those spoilers soon because I don't have any immediate plans to see in the theater. What I did with Episode 7 is I saw it like a little into the new year. Basically around the time when I could just go to the theater and I don't have to worry about the theater being packed, so. Ugh. I died to this boss. Ugh.
The first trailer that I saw for Last Jedi was when I went to see Thor Ragnarok.
Okay.
Ooh, ouch.
Yeah, so my ultimate preference would actually to be have like a physical like cartridge version of Sonic Mania on the Switch, but they never made a physical copy for the Switch. It's digital or nothing. That's why I elected to go for with Steam, because like, if I'm gonna download something with DRM, Steam kinda has my trust in that area, whereas Nintendo does not. If my Switch breaks and dies, what happens to my digital library?
You just pick a god and pray.
Mm-hmm. For until I can get a clear answer from Nintendo that I can recover my digital library without, like, calling the Nintendo hotline a dozen times, I just refuse to go digital on the Switch. I want a cartridge, so.
I would love to know where those hotlines are located.
There was one in California, if I remember right. I forgot.
So I think some comedian made a joke about that. They never tell you where they are exactly.
So, but the Nintendo Hotline, they did have a, like, their help desk. I think it was in California, if I remember right. Either that or it was something West Coast, I forgot. There's documentaries on it, because there's, like, interviews with people who used to work at Nintendo Power, and the fact that to help people, that they would, like, have handwritten guides that everybody on the Nintendo Power Hotline would write for each other to be able to help people with games, and, like, they would have, like, calls that they would get into all the time, like, for example, Star Tropics and the letter you had to dip in the water. People would be like, what's the code for the robot? And they would just have the answer memorized.
There you go.
So, look it up. There's documentaries, like, on YouTube about it, and somewhere there they'll mention where the Nintendo Power Hotline was, at least at the time, located. And I wouldn't be surprised if they're still located there, actually. So, hey, good evening, Nate. About to say, we're playing through Sonic Mania. You're free to join the Discord. So, tell me if you've beaten Sonic CD yet or not, because I know that was a game that you said that you needed to beat at some point. But speaking of Sonic CD, we are in Metallic Madness, which is a Sonic CD level, so...
Speaking of Ragnarok, have you had a chance to see that yet?
Ragnarok? No. I guess I'll be that... I'll be that guy who it feels like he's living under a rock right now. Ragnarok. What is it?
It's the latest Marvel movie, Thor Ragnarok.
Oh, shoot. Okay. That sounds like a movie my girlfriend might ask if we can go watch, because usually when I end up going to see Marvel movies, it's one of her recommendations, so I'll keep that in mind.
Marvel is an instant see in theaters.
I'm just about to say, the movies that they've been putting out have all been, at least typically, really, really good. So, yeah, go for it.
What about Justice League?
Shoot, did I see that? I'm just going to say that no, I didn't see it. But for whatever reason, I'm remembering, like, a Justice League-like movie, but my memory is horrible right now, so... Also, holy moly, what happened there? That was very weird with the hitboxes and the screen scrolling and everything. Shoot, what was the movie? It, like, had the Hulk and Iron Man in it, and... I remember, like, the main plot of the movie was, like, there was this, like, floating island that was, like, going to come crashing down into a city.
Age of Ultron.
Yes.
Age of Ultron? Okay, thank you.
Thank you, person who I don't know.
That would be Nate. Good evening, Nate.
Hello.
I'm glad you know your Marvel movies, because my experience is that my girlfriend wants to see them, so therefore I go see them, and I remember details, but because it wasn't really my thing, I... forget stuff like the title of the movie. I apologize, everybody. I guess you could say I'm not really the Marvel guy, so.
I was late. I was watching the Mr. Robot finale.
Okay. How's that?
You should watch it. It's good.
Okay.
Realistic hacking for ya.
This room is really crazy and weird, and I don't think I've ever gone into it before. Wow. Oh, jeez, did I really hit both platform puzzles that are in this level? I totally did. Can I just fly out of this? Okay, yes, I can. Why didn't I do that earlier? Okay. Yeah, I guess I'll ask you again, Nate. I'm not sure if you commented it in the Twitch chat. Oh, you still have not started Sonic CD, is that right?
Correct.
Okay. So since the last time I played Sonic CD was when I was a child / teenager, my opinion might be skewed, but it's a good Sonic game, so I would recommend it. And the remake has Tails, so the best character. Speaking of things, this boss, I know as a fact, is actually a reference to a Knuckles Chaotix boss, and that is a game that I have not played, Knuckles Chaotix, which I'm surprised I didn't play because my dad did have a 32X and a couple games for it, but not Knuckles Chaotix. That was actually my first introduction to Doom, of all things, was on the 32X, and at my time I thought that's what Doom was. It was that game on the Sega 32X that everybody thought was good. And it turns out the 32X version is actually like one of the worst versions of Doom.
Because I ended up missing it, how'd you do on the Puyo Puyo boss?
Puyo Puyo boss, I ended up not building any combos, but it didn't matter because Eggman's AI was terrible for me that time, so I won.
Hey, well,
I am not a Puyo Puyo player, but thankfully that boss doesn't require you to be one. My puzzle game when I grew up was more Tetris than Puyo Puyo, so...
Ah, good old Tetris.
So, I know you haven't played Sonic CD yet. Let me ask this follow-up question. Have you played Sonic Mania, Nate?
I don't even know it yet.
Oh, yeah, well, I guess you wouldn't have had to been able to play it then yet.
I've played through both Sonic 4 games.
The Sonic 4 and Sonic 4 Episode 2?
Yep.
Okay. Those are games that I did not pick up, and at the time I remember like one of my YouTube subscriptions, AzureBlade49, did a playthrough. He actually played through both. By that time he played through Sonic 1, and I guess it just wasn't looking too interesting to me. And I've come to learn after the fact that actually the physics in Sonic 4 Episode 1 are like not correct, so. Not to say that they're bad games, because they are not bad games, it's just, relatively speaking, they control differently, and a lot of people who like really like this classic Genesis Sonic the Hedgehog type game probably really did not like Sonic 4 just because it just felt wrong.
Yeah, I enjoyed it.
A lot of people give Dimps crap, and I guess I can understand because their level design patterns did start to get stale around, say, Sonic Rush-ish, and that it definitely showed in Sonic 4. But, yeah. they made good Sonic games. The problem was they didn't have any other ideas, especially level design-wise, so, yeah. I had lots of good memories playing the Sonic Advance games, and those were all made by Dimps, so... Ooh, jeez, okay, it's really easy to be crushed here, so I gotta be careful.
I have the Sonic game for the Neo Geo Pocket Color.
Ooh, the Neo Geo Pocket Color, I'm trying to think which one that is.
There's one that nobody remembers, since it was like a cheap Game Boy-like one.
I'm not familiar, though for whatever reason it sounds familiar. I might have to look it up.
I have the game come to two really obscure Game Boy type systems.
Okay, there we go, let's get up here. So since we were discussing Odyssey earlier as well, do you have a Nintendo Switch, Nate, or is that...
Not
no,
yet.
You don't have one. Not yet. Do you want to get one?
Yeah.
Alright. Well, you and Higsby, and probably a lot of other people, hopefully your Christmas basket has a Nintendo Switch in it.
Hopefully. But I just got that 2DS like 4 months ago.
Okay.
I also plan on getting a Switch eventually, mainly for Mario Odyssey.
I don't blame ya. So. Yeah, I am of the opinion part of the reason the Switch is successful is because Nintendo had a first party, in this case a Zelda game, ready for launch right off the bat that everybody wanted. Like, Nintendo needs that when they launch a console. If they don't have a Zelda or Mario game ready for launch, the console is gonna struggle. So, and I'm trying to think what the Wii U even had, and the fact that I can't think of what the Wii U had, that's part of the reason why it didn't do so well.
I don't think the Wii U had any first party games ready to go at launch.
Big mistake.
Except for maybe a new Super Mario Bros. Wii U, but that's about it.
I wouldn't call that the must buy this game kind of game. So honestly, I mean, nothing particularly wrong with it because I have played through New Super Mario Bros. U. I still need to do Luigi U now that I think about it. I haven't done Luigi U, but I've done New all Super the other.
Mario Brothers was launched up for Wii U.
So, yeah, New Super Luigi U I haven't done. There was a time where it was just a DLC, but I believe you can get it standalone now. I hope it doesn't go for like $1 million because, like, I don't have a copy of Luigi U. And it would be nice to pick one up.
We should do make another Mario Galaxy game.
We'll see.
I'm gonna take part of the first one.
So yeah, back to Sonic Mania. The stage we're currently in is the Titanic Monarch, and we're actually specifically in Act 2. And while I don't know if this is for sure, like, a thing, but it's something that I read about and it makes sense, is that the concept for Titanic Monarch came pretty heavily from the cut zone idea from Sonic 2 of Genocide City, which I could kind of see a little bit. This zone, to me, though, reminds me a lot of Carnival Night Zone, as if it was Carnival Night Zone but evil, because it has a lot of Carnival Night Zone stage elements.
Just please, no barrels.
No barrels, thankfully, but it has all the bumpers and just the weird, like, shapey architecture to it, and, like, the grates here that are right here, and, like, the ball things that rotate you around like that. Like, it very much reminds me of Carnival Night Zone, as if Carnival Night Zone was a final level. Maybe I wouldn't have been so irritated about getting stuck at the barrel if it was the final level. Or maybe I would have been, so...
So what is the purpose of each section in this area?
So yeah, this level is, it's divided into four different sections, and I guess the idea is that this level is very non-linear. You do have to go through all four sections to get to the end. It's actually a decently long zone if you don't know what you're doing. So, but the good news, though, just as a slight minor spoiler, is if you do get to the boss, the timer does stop. So if you get to the end before you hit 10 minutes, you do not get a time over, which was actually something that I saw in one of the reviews for Sonic Mania, is that the 10-minute time limit was actually a problem for the person who was reviewing it, because he was actually running out of time in zones. I personally didn't run into that issue. But I could see, because the zones in Sonic Mania are, I would say, longer than what you typically find in a classic Sonic game, so I could see the 10-minute time limit actually coming into being an issue, but I didn't run into that as an issue. With that said, the 10-minute time limit in a Sonic zone, when you think about it, especially when you do have longer zones like this, you probably could have gotten away with removing that, and I don't think anyone would have cried foul, like, where's my 10-minute time limit? People complain about the weirdest things, though.
I think the only time the timer was ever really an issue for me was coming back to the Carnival Zone from Sonic 3.
Oh, and the dumb barrel, yeah, it was an issue there. As I mentioned earlier, when I was a kid, I spent forever just trying to find a different way through Carnival Night Zone Act 2 because, like, I couldn't get past the barrel, and I just thought I was not good at the game, and I thought I had to either get better at the barrel or find another way around the barrel. So, like, I spent forever trying to find an alternate path in that level, and none exists that go around the barrel.
Yeah. I think I would get past it, then I noticed I had, like, 1 minute to get to the nearest checkpoint, and hopefully I would get to it, and then I would just let the timer run out, and then I just continue through the rest of the zone.
Yeah. Oh, childhood memories. Dumb barrel. As I mentioned before, that wasn't the only time I got stuck in Sonic 3. I got stuck at the Hydrosity sub-boss, the one that goes into the water up and down again like it's in the washing machine, because I couldn't for the life of me figure out how I was supposed to hit it because I kept getting stuck in the washing machine water, so. But with that said, we have actually made it to the end. This is the final boss, and because we are not playing as Sonic, or as, you actually get this if you're playing in Knuckles and Knuckles mode. There is no extra boss for us. We just have to beat Eggman and win, which I should have enough rings to be able to cheese this boss all the way. Not like that, though.
Did Tails just magically change colors?
Yeah, the color palette here is kind of weird, so you did make a correct observation.
Okay. And I know my eyesight is bad and I'm partially colorblind, but...
And maybe it could be the stream, but no, I can tell you Tails... his palette is different here.
Oh, I should note that they have a Vegas Pro Humble Bundle going on.
Really?
A Vegas 14 Pro Edit.
There we go, and we get the best animation of Eggman pouncing and moaning because he just beat him. And then we get to leave the area. So yeah, if you're playing as Sonic and Tails, if you're playing as Sonic as the main character and have all the Chaos Emeralds, there is a bonus boss. You also get that bonus boss if you're playing in the Knuckles and Knuckles mode, but sadly Tails can never get the bonus boss. Unless there's something I can do to get the bonus boss's Tails, I would like to know. But with that said, that was a playthrough of Sonic Mania. If watching this hasn't convinced you to get this game, I don't know what will. Because, yeah, this game is awesome. And to the fan creators who became actual developers and made this Sonic game, thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Christian Whitehead and Headcanon and Pagoda West Games, you are all very awesome. So yeah, that was Sonic Mania. It's awesome. Pick it up. I really don't have much else to say, because it's, well, awesome. So I think I'm going to go ahead and let the credits play, which I don't think I've actually done since the first time I've beaten the game, so we can see all the fan game developers that Sega gave a chance. I guess another concluding thought I can give, Nintendo, I hope you're paying attention to what Sega and Sonic Team did here. Because there's a lot of people in the Mario fan game community who do really, really, really good work. Maybe consider plucking a couple of those guys out and say, go make a fan game. We'll give you the resources and the copyright to do it. And watch them make some kind of Mario Mania. It'll be really good. Or Paper Mario Mania. That would be even better. I say that because there are lots of people out there who know what makes a good Paper Mario game. In your latest attempts, by Intelligent Systems, God bless their hearts, they tried. But what they've been told to make, and just, no, I don't want to play it. And, like, I look at how Intelligent Systems designed Sticker Star and Color Splash. Those are polished games. They're just not fun. Come on, guys. The only thing I like about those games is their music, okay? I have their OSTs downloaded. I actually need to go through Color Splash's OST, but it's like really jazzy and awesome. And like, I would personally argue the graphics and like the art design in those games, awesome, spot on, wonderful. But the game sucks! Why? Why you do this to Paper Mario?
No, Miles, I don't think I've ever heard you rant like that.
Okay. It's been a while. To conclude, Sonic Mania is awesome. Please buy it.
Well, Miles, this was a lot of fun. Thank you for letting me co-commentate.
Hey, thanks for hopping in. And thanks to Yoshizilla, who opted in earlier. Since I am on Twitch, I might have to refresh my page, but I don't think he's streaming online. I do see Proton John is streaming, so I'll probably hop into his stream after the fact. I don't think I have enough of a viewership to try to trigger a raid on him, though, so...
No,
I don't. That's unfortunate. But let's let these credits roll out before we complete the stream. Yeah, I suppose since you haven't been doing Sonic CD or Sonic Media, what have you been playing as of late, Nate?
you know, Ferrari, went back in FTL again.
Okay. There is a small thing relating to school that I did want to discuss, but I'll actually discuss that off stream because it does bring up, like, people's names and whatnot that I'd personally prefer not to say on stream, so, hang around when I end the stream, Nate, okay?
Right.
Alright, well, I'm going to head out. I'll see you next week.
Thank you. Yeah, have a good night and a good week, General. I'm going to check my Twitch like profile page after this stream, and if I qualify to apply for affiliate, I'm totally going to go for it, and we'll see how it goes. I did once apply to be a Twitch partner because I thought to myself, you know, I can sell myself. I can write a paragraph. I can try to show credentials. You know, I have like 8,000 subscribers and everything. And like I spent like an hour writing up some good stuff to submit to them, and then of course they come back and say no, you don't qualify to be a Twitch partner. And I was actually told it was just because I didn't have like the stats on Twitch. So I took that as meaning whoever got my application was probably like, this person put way more effort into this application than most people do, but this guy just doesn't have the stats. So if I do end up entertaining you guys enough to be worthy enough to get the stats to go for Twitch partner, I totally will. But I gotta do it. I gotta entertain you guys. That is part of being a streamer. And if I don't do that, I don't deserve it, after all.
Well, best of luck.
Thank you. But at the very least, hopefully I can at least get the Twitch affiliate and the three emotes, and we'll figure out what we want for those emotes. Emotes are a craze, and I know some people like using emotes. Oh, shoot. Okay, when I click away from the game, it just pauses. I was about to chat in my own chat. Okay, I think that's an appropriate emote for this moment. That would be Proton Disappointed. Alright. Wow, these credits do go on for a while, and we made it over to the legal team, and now the finance team, people who took care of the money. These people know how to manage and take care of money, including Tak Hao. I'm going to point you out, Tak Hao. You're the management, or what was that, I didn't quite read that all the way. Oh, and the IT team! Can't forget the IT team! Man, I would love to be an IT guy for like a game studio or whatnot. Because it'd be like my general job that I currently do right now wouldn't change that much, but like my actual business would be, instead of providing IT services, they would be, you know, the actual business would be a studio, game studio, and be like, wow, okay, and now I need to get some servers and networks up and running that helps these game designers and developers manage their files and videos and whatnot. Let's get you 10 gigabit Ethernet! Yes! It probably costs too much money, honestly. Studios usually struggle with money. Ah, but I want my 10 gigabit Ethernet. No! My 10 gigabit Ethernet. I say that, and I have fast Ethernet at home. Though the only reason I have fast Ethernet at home is because I have a Cisco 48 port switch that has 48 fast Ethernet ports, 2 gigabit Ethernet ports that I'm currently using in my network. And it's like, I have a Cisco 48 port switch. This thing probably cost thousands and thousands of dollars when it was originally sold. And it was given to me because the switch is now end of life and no longer supported by Cisco. And I have a 48 port switch. And it's at that point that I did a smile with my face, with a big smile. I have a 48 port switch! Smile. It's like, what are you gonna do with the 48 port switch? I have 4 things connected to it. What are you gonna do with the other 46 ports? Because there's 48 ports and 2 gigabit Ethernet ports. It's like, I don't know. They're all shut down right now. Loop back! Alright. Well, that has been Sonic Mania. Thanks, everybody, for watching, whether it's been on Twitch or when I get this up on YouTube. Thanks again, and see you next time.